Happy Easter. Will you stand with us as we open with a responsive greeting this morning? Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Where, O death, is your victory? Almighty God, through Christ, you gave us everlasting life. By the power of your Holy Spirit, please show us today a glimpse of that new life as we reflect upon your glory. Amen. Amen. Let's sing in worship. Christ the Lord is risen today.
Morning, and welcome to Harlem Baptist Church. If you are a guest or a first-time visitor, we just want to say thank you for joining us this morning. Glad that you came out and chose to worship the Lord with us. We hope that our worship service will be a powerful time for all of us, families old and new. But for especially for guests, I do want to make you aware of in the pew in front of you, there are two different types of connection cards. One's the old-fashioned, fill out your name and everything. But the other one, if you're more technologically savvy, which is not me because I inherited all my mom's genes and she still is not sure how to turn on the computer at home. But if you're not like that, if you're not like us, you're better than we are. She is here. I'm saying this in front of her. That's okay. So what is she going to do? I'm still her son at the end of the day. There's a QR code and you can scan that. And when you do, pray for me later that she doesn't give me the business. Welcome, guests. Welcome. Just a few quick announcements before a word of prayer. The first thing is, parents of littles, parents of children, you've looked around already and probably noticed that we do not have Blast Children's Worship today. So children pretty much who have graduated from the nursery through high school, they're expected to stay in worship with us the whole time today. But there's a couple of things to help that go smoothly, since that's not the normal. It's just because this is a fifth Sunday of the month, which is always designated as our family worship day. We have the activity workbooks, and I meant to bring that in here. But if you want to excuse yourself in just a minute, that's totally fine. You can grab one of those. It's got some crayons and some stuff for the kiddos to do. But we also have something called a respite room. So whether, you know, there's a throw down, or even if you just your pants are too tight and you need a break and you're overstimulated, there's a room for you, and there's a TV on with our worship on the screen. You can kind of worship from afar in the privacy and quiet of that room and just relax. Where is it? Yeah, that's a good question. Thanks, wife. It is in one of our children's Sunday school classes, so straight back the hallway and then to the left. Is that? Follow, there's pretty signs. If I can find it, you can find it. We'll be all right. So those are a few quick announcements there. We do have an Awana children's musical and performance this Wednesday night at 6:30 p.m. with ice cream to follow. So that's fun. Y'all, please come to that, especially if your kids are active in Awana services. Be there on Wednesday night, 6:30. Then we want to let you know about our annual church-wide spring fling, which is on Sunday, May 5th. If my math's right, that's 5 weeks from today. It's Nacho Average Spring Fling, since it's on Cinco de Mayo. So May 5th, spring fling. And then finally, Harlem Baptist Pre-K registration starts today for church members, and it will be opened up to everybody this Thursday, April 4th. Harlem Baptist Pre-K will be in its second year next year, and I know that the teachers and Lindsay, who is our director, are ramping up for an even better year. Although we had a great start this year, we want to keep adding and really fill all those spots. So Pre-K registration starting this week. Let's go to the word and go to the Lord with a word of prayer. Father, we love you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to come and gather in your house, Lord. We pray that you help lead us in a powerful time where we worship in spirit and truth, and that our worship would be a pleasing offering to you, and it would be a sacrifice that we would make to give you worship this morning. We love you. Amen.
Let's stand and continue in worship this morning.
Y'all can sit for just a moment. I know my Awana kids know this one. I know they can out-sing you, so y'all better give your best, okay?
I was buried beneath my shame.
was sinking deep in sin.
And I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me. Now saved am I. Oh, love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help,
will lift me.
Good morning. In the span of 40 days, and in the span of just a couple of pages in your Bible, two important questions were asked, both that started with the same word, that word being why. And I'll tell you, both of these questions were asked of some of Jesus' closest followers. And I'm going to take a moment and just read both of these short passages and make a quick point about them, because I think they speak volumes. The first is from Luke chapter 24. This is right after the death of Jesus on the cross and his burial, and this is the following morning as the Marys have gone out to the tomb. In Luke chapter 24, verse 4, it says, "While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, 'Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee that the Son of Man would be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.' Then they remembered his words." So the first question that this is directed towards Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, they went to the tomb to take care of the body, and instead they find the stone was rolled away, and these two men in clothes with gleaming lightning say, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" And then Acts chapter 1, this time, just like I said, 40 days later, another question from angelic beings in verse 9. After Jesus said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking up intently into the skies he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." In the space of 40 days, Jesus' closest friends, his closest followers, twice went looking for him and didn't find him where they expected to see him. And really, the second wasn't a true search, but they were watching in the middle of this incredible happening as Jesus ascends into heaven. And angels come and they ask, "Why? Why are you looking where you're looking?" And when you put these two passages together, to me, it makes a small point, and that is that Jesus is always on to the next thing before we've fully caught up. It's amazing to me that his disciples, the people who spent the most amount of time with Jesus, they still, after all the time they've spent at his side, listening to him teach, listening to him preach, watching him minister, they never fully were 100% like understanding of his plan. And that speaks to the fact that God is so much higher than we are. But he is on to the new, and he is on to the next. He says, Behold, I am making all things new, and we're still looking for the living among the dead, or we're looking at the sky. In that Acts chapter 1 verse, I wish it could have said this. It's okay that it doesn't, but the way I read into it, it's almost like those two men, these two angels that appear, they're saying, "Hey, why are you wasting your time looking in the sky? There's work to be done. There's work to be done." If we, as Easter people who celebrate Easter, if we never move beyond the amazing thing that's happened, the amazing thing that Jesus did when he died on the cross and was raised from the dead and ascended into heaven, and if we don't get to work, we are like those who are still looking for him among the dead. But he has a broader mission that he allows us to be a part of, and is for us to be a part of his work as he establishes his earthly kingdom before he comes to reclaim it for himself again. So this morning, the kind of invitation, the challenge I just want to issue to you as Miss Edie is about to play and give us time to pray, I just want to ask you, what part of your life do you need to catch up to what Christ is trying to do? What part of your life are you just struggling just a little bit behind where he's trying to lead? Because I know that I spend an awful lot of time doing nothing, at least in terms of spiritual significance, matters of importance, the spiritual consequence, I just, you know, I've busied myself with lesser affairs. I am looking for the living among the dead, or I'm looking at the sky. I'm just not caught up to the new work that Jesus has in front of me. And praise God that we have a Christ who is powerful, and he is always on the move. He is always active and at work. I want to ask you to be, to just now think about, how can I be a part of his work too? So let's pray. God, when it comes to my spiritual life, I don't want to be a day late and a dollar short. The Christian life is not a life that's called to be stagnant, but rather that of just of work and progress and moving forward in moving faithfully and obediently in the path that you are directing us. I feel like if there's a time in our life, if there's a season of our lives when we are walking with you where we just feel like we've not moved anywhere, then we need to examine ourselves. We need to find out, are we in the right place with you relationally? Because you will always be leading us towards works that you have prepared in advance for us to do. God, I pray this morning for all who are here that we would commit ourselves to pray about how you want us to be used. It is an incredible thing what you can do with absolutely no skills and no abilities that we bring to you other than just a willing spirit. You can change the world. And you have mobilized your people, starting in Acts, starting at Pentecost with the coming of the Holy Spirit, to change the world in the course of history forever through your power, that same power that is in us today, the same power that defeated death, the same power that led to there being an empty tomb. God, we praise you for that power this morning. We thank you. We celebrate it. But I ask that you help us live it out. Amen.
stand and continue in worship with us this morning.
We sing hallelujah. We sing
Thank you that you did not leave us alone. Thank you that you did not leave us broken, that you took our sin and placed it on Jesus. Jesus, thank you for being our Savior. Thank you for putting aside your will and going to the cross willingly. You were not a victim going to the cross. You did it because you loved us. I can't get over that. Holy Spirit, thank you for filling us. Thank you for being with us so that we have the deposit guaranteeing our inheritance, because Christ is alive and living in us today. Oh, Lord, is there no better thing than to sing together, He is alive? Is there nothing we would rather do?
Happy Easter. I hope that you all have had a wonderful morning thus far. This has been a great time of worship. It's been encouraging for me. Hopefully it has been for you as well. I'm excited about what God is going to do through our time of teaching, learning. You know, this past Friday, we did something here at Harlem Baptist. We don't do a lot, but we do on occasion when we get asked, and that is we hosted a funeral for someone a family who did not have another church, another place to have a funeral. And I had no part other than unlocking doors, okay? So I sat in my office this past week on Friday, working on this sermon as people were coming in. And I noticed something that's not surprising at all. You're going to think it's weird for me to just mention this. But I noticed as people were walking by my office, there's glass in my door, that everyone was wearing what color? Black. Yeah. And that doesn't usually catch my attention, but for some reason on Friday it did. And it seemed weird to me that that caught my attention, because when I conduct a funeral, I wear a black suit generally. If I attend a funeral, I'm wearing some sort of dark color. That seems to be appropriate. Black seems to be the cultural color of grief and mourning. But for some reason on Friday it caught my attention. And I think it was because Friday was what? It was Good Friday. Although we typically refer to the Friday before Easter as Good Friday, I think sometimes we might wonder why. Why is the Friday where Christ died? Why do we call it Good Friday? We might would more appropriately call it Black Friday, but that's taken. Why do we call it Good Friday, when Christ, who was unjustly arrested, when he was betrayed by a friend, when he was beaten, when he was nailed to a cross, why do we call this a good thing? But it was. We're going to talk about that this morning. I think the Apostle Paul helps us perhaps to see this a good bit. In fact, Paul argues that it wasn't just Christ who died on Good Friday. And he talks about this in Romans chapter 6. So I invite you to join me in reading these words of the Apostle Paul from Romans chapter 6. If you don't have your Bibles, feel free to use one of the pew racks in front of you. I would love for you to follow along as we read this passage together. Your bulletin says we're going to begin in verse 3, but we're going to begin in verse 1. I was wrong. Okay? Hear the reading of God's word. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. In verse 8. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Now, some of you may find it a bit surprising that on Easter Sunday, I have chosen not to preach from any of the resurrection accounts. In our sunrise service this morning, I did the same thing. So if you came twice expecting to hear that, I apologize. Hopefully you won't leave here disappointed this morning. Because as I was thinking about what to preach this morning, what text to preach, I landed on Romans 6 because I felt like Paul does a good job of helping us to think through the implications of the resurrection. What does the resurrection event mean? Now, I suspect most of us here understand that it is through the resurrection of Christ that we get to enter into eternal life. We get salvation. But I think there's also a deeper meaning for us. In fact, there's meaning for us now on March 31st, 2024, and in the days that we will live on this earth, as well as future eternal implications. Romans chapter 6, I think it helps us to connect both the present and the future implications of this resurrection event. You see, it's tempting for Christ followers to identify more with the risen, with the victorious Christ Jesus than with the Christ who suffered and crucified. We don't really like to live on Good Friday, and we shouldn't. But I think we need to recognize and understand the great implications of that event. Before we hurry to the empty tomb, Paul insists that we linger for a while at the foot of the cross. After all, as Paul states, because Christ was crucified, something in his followers was also crucified. It is at the cross where Christ died and within the tomb where Christ was buried where we find, I believe, the present implications of the gospel narrative. At the end of Romans chapter 5, Paul basically states he's been teaching about sin. And he's been teaching that as we become aware of the law, our sinfulness, we become more aware of our sinfulness. And he says, as our sin increases, so too does what? Grace. And then he kind of anticipates this question on the part of his Romans reader. He anticipates that perhaps the reader is going to begin to wonder, well, if this grace of God is so good and we need everyone to see it, then perhaps the best thing for me to do is to sin all the more so that way Christ's good grace can be seen all the more. That's essentially the question that Paul poses here in verse 1 of chapter 6. Paul likes to use these rhetorical questions. But he answers his own question with an exclamatory statement at the beginning of verse 2 saying, by no means. But then he poses another question. And essentially he asks in this second question, how can someone go on sinning if that sin has died? Once something is dead, it is no longer. In verse 3, Paul explains how we die to sin. He talks about baptism. I suspect if you've been baptized, if you've seen baptisms, you know that most pastors, this is what I say, they take the person under and they say, buried with Christ in baptism. We don't leave them under the water though, right? And then we raise them to walk in newness of life. We're going to get to that. But right now, let's talk about this buried with Christ in baptism. This is what Paul is talking about here. There is really a lot of death talk in this passage. Not something you expect the preacher to talk about on Easter Sunday. In fact, in these verses, Paul uses the Greek, two Greek words for death about a dozen times. That's a lot in 11 verses. When Jesus died, Paul insists that something within his followers died also. This is a common theme for many in Paul's writings. I want to share with you a scripture from Galatians chapter 2. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. And I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. What does Paul mean when he says that we have died with Christ? What does he mean? Paul teaches that our death with Christ is our death to sin. And to be dead to sin means that sin no longer has control over our lives. Sin continues to attempt to dominate the life and the conduct of believers. But Paul insists again that in baptism we participate in the death of Christ and we put sin to death. I wish it was as easy as I'm baptized, I come up, sin no more is something that's tempting. That's not, Paul is not suggesting that in baptism that we come up out of the baptismal waters and that we just walk on easy peasy, no more sins. It's easy. No more temptation. That's not the way it works. In fact, if your experience is like mine, upon coming into relationship with Christ, Satan tends to attack all the more. It's harder and harder to fight against that sin. What Paul is trying to help us understand, and he says it well in verse 6 and 7, when he talks about us being slaves to sin, he says, you are no longer slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Paul is helping us understand that in baptism, in professing Christ Jesus, we no longer have to live according to that sinful nature. This past week, as I was studying this passage, I came across a quote from a second century theologian, a guy named Origen of Alexandria. Brilliant guy. And he says this, he says, to obey the cravings of sin is to be alive to sin. But not to obey the cravings of sin, not to succumb to the will of sin, this is to die to sin. Paul wants us to understand how Jesus' death frees us from the bondage of sin. You see, Christ's death for sin becomes our death to sin. Let me say that again. I want you to get that. Christ's death for sin becomes our death to sin. We no longer have to be slave to the sinful nature of our world and of our lives. In Christ, we can get rid of that. In verses 6 and 7, it says, our old self was crucified with Christ so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with. Sometimes it's helpful in my study to turn to Eugene Peterson's The Message paraphrase because it helps me see things in a different light. This is how Peterson says this. He says, our old way of life was nailed to the cross with Christ. Paul really wants us to absorb this. He repeats himself a lot. And he wants us to understand that believers are, by definition, those who, by their union with Christ, they died with him on the cross. And I want you guys to understand that this death is necessary. Further down in Romans chapter 6, perhaps the most famous verse in Romans chapter 6, Paul says, the wages of sin is what? All right, you're with me, just making sure. But here's the thing, my friends, the wage has been paid. The price for sinfulness has been paid. And because Christ's death came and he paid that wage, something new is now able to begin in our lives. Jesus' story, friends, it didn't end at the tomb. In fact, it was at the tomb where the new chapter begins. And we are here today because Jesus didn't stay in the tomb, which is precisely why we all are wearing something other than black. We're not here mourning. We're not here grief-stricken. Rather, we are rejoicing. We go back to verse 4. And Paul says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, and here's the really important part, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. We may have been crucified with Christ, friends. We may have been buried with Christ, but we were also raised. We will also be raised to new life with Christ. Paul continues to talk about this in verses 5, in verse 8, again in verse 11. Paul is careful not to stop at our sin being put to death. He wants us to understand because our old life, because our old sinful nature was put to death, that then we can walk in new life. And I think we do that in two distinct ways. I think we can walk in this new life in two distinct ways. There is a present implication and there is a future implication. So let's talk about in the present. How do we walk in new life now in this world? You see, as Christ was raised from the dead through the glorious power of the Father, so also are we raised to an entirely new way of living through the power and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Friends, the lives of believers are to be as different from their pre-conversion days as life is from death. I want you to get that. The life of the believer is to look as different from our pre-conversion days as life looks different from death. That is pretty convicting. I want you to imagine for a moment what your pre-conversion day looked like. If you are a Christ follower, what did your life look like before you gave your life to Christ? I suspect many of our lives were marked with anger and marked with hatred and marked with lust and marked with dishonesty. Now let me ask, does your life look different from that today? It should. We're called to walk in new life. We are called to be different. I want to again quote from Galatians chapter 5. I believe we have this text on the screen. Galatians 5 verse 16. Walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. He goes on and says, for the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. If you were to look in Galatians chapter 5, that's where we find what's called the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians 5, Paul teaches us the fruit of the Spirit. But what's really interesting to me, and it's very helpful to me, is when we see the fruit of the Spirit in chapters 5, verses 22 and 23. Before that, Paul identifies the acts of the flesh. So he really paints a good picture between what our pre-conversion life looked like and what our post-conversion life looked like. He says in verse 19, the acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissension, and he keeps going on and on. And then in verse 22, he says, but the fruit of the Spirit, those who are living in Christ-likeness, they produce love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And then we get to verse 24. I want to put this one on the screen as well. Galatians 5, verse 24. He says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and with its desires. Does this sound familiar? This is what we are to look like. In 2 Corinthians 5, 17, we're going to put this one on the screen as well. Paul says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. You see, Paul is consistent in each of these epistles. To belong to Christ is to crucify our sinful passions and desires. It is to be made new. What once was before Christ, friends, it is no more. But I feel like it's important that I share with you that this new doesn't come without a cost. in Luke chapter 9. In fact, Matthew, Mark, and Luke's gospel all record this part of Jesus' words. In Luke chapter 9, verses 23 and 24, he says, "Then he said to them," that's Jesus speaking, "whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves. He must take up their cross daily, must follow me, for whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will save it." There's a cost to following Christ. A part of us must die. We must put aside. We cannot walk in new life until we have given up that old life. I said earlier that this new life also speaks of future implications. If we go back and we look at Romans 6, we see most all, with I think one exception, when Paul is talking about this new life, he's always talking in the future sense. He wants us to understand that although we have died with Christ, we have not been resurrected with Christ yet, and that will not happen until Christ's return. But because Christ was raised, we can look into a future hope. We can cling to this hope. As Paul says, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. You know, Easter is generally marked with celebrations. I suspect many of you are going to leave today. You're going to go home. You're going to eat a great meal. Or maybe better yet, you're going to someone else's house and you're going to eat their great meal. And you don't have to do the dishes or anything like that. Perfect. Easter is generally marked with celebrations. But I want us to recognize that as we celebrate today with loved ones, we are testifying to one another that we can have a restored life. We can have a new life because of the resurrection. You see, the death of Christ is a critical part of his resurrection. It is the critical part of the gospel. It is a critical part of the gospel of Christ. It is part of the good news. This is why we call it Good Friday. Because although the death of Christ was unjust, although it causes grief, it caused grief for Paul, for Jesus' apostles, it causes us to mourn as we reflect on his passion. We must realize that his death on the cross was indeed good, because without Jesus' death, sin would not have been defeated. And without Jesus' death, you and I, we would be forever enslaved to the sin. We couldn't help but sin. And as a result, we would have to pay that wage. We would have to pay that wage for our sinfulness. And without Jesus' death, there would be no grave to overcome. You see, we do understand that the wages of sin is death. But Paul continues in 6 verse 23, "But the gift of God is eternal life in" who? In Christ Jesus. My friends, Jesus paid the wage of sin. He freed us from slavery to sin through his death, and he has made a new life. Through Jesus' death, we receive life. Death is the gateway, my friends, to life. It is the gateway to immortality. And in Christ's death, sin was forever defeated, but in his resurrection, death itself was defeated. The cross may have been sin's final move, but the empty grave was God's checkmate. The game is over, and sin is forever in defeat. And friends, our lives should reflect this good news. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, we have gathered here in your house, God, to worship a God who we believe is alive and active. Lord, we gather here, and I am mindful of the global church, people across the world who are all worshiping a risen Savior today. What a powerful testimony that is to the unbelieving world. And I pray, God, that you will help us to be a people who leave this place and we proclaim this good news. That we were once dead in sin, but because of Christ's death, we no longer are a slave to that. And because of Christ's resurrection, we now get to walk in a new life, here and eternally. So we ask, God, that your Spirit would fill us, that your Spirit would guide us as we strive to move forward in Christ's likeness. May our lives be a reflection of this gospel story in all that we do. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. As we come to our time of response, our worship team is going to lead us in a familiar song. But I'm going to be down front to receive anyone who feels perhaps in need for prayer. If there's something going on in your life and I can pray for you, I would consider it an honor and a privilege to be able to pray for you this morning. Maybe you say, Carson, I believe in Christ Jesus, but I have never shared that with anyone. I've never professed that. Or I want to talk to you about what it means to walk with Christ, to be a follower of Christ. I would love to talk with you this morning and in the days to come about what it means to follow Jesus. Maybe there's someone out there who says, Carson, I want to be on mission with this church. I know it's not a perfect church, but I'm imperfect and I want to be on y'all's missional team here in Harlem. I would love to talk to you about membership as well. We're going to sing now this song together, if y'all will stand.
Find in me thine all in all.
bless you now with the sure knowledge that Christ has paid the full price for your redemption once and for all time. You are set free to be a blessing to all you meet this week as you eagerly await Christ's return. Amen. Happy Easter.